It's pretty interesting to see how people connect with God in the perspective of their own culture. My thought about going down to Dallas was I'm going to go down there, give people Jesus, give people hope. But it really changed to how they really impacted me.
I feel like it was this amazing experience where we really got to see like how the church really should be. And it was very impactful for the students and the adults that went.
Well, going down there, I thought I was going to be the one that was giving them hope, giving them encouragement in their faith. But really, what they needed wasn't me. It was really just a word of encouragement from God.
From our standpoint, we thought we were going to serve people. We thought that we were going to be the one showing love or showing grace, showing mercy. And the reality was, I think that they were showing us love. They were showing us what love looked like, what grace looked like. There were drug dealers, there were prostitutes, but more than anything, we saw redeemed people wanting to redeem people.
Going on this mission trip really gave me the courage to love everyone here in GI just as much as I did in Dallas.
After this trip, it's like really brought me to like, I can do so much things here in Grand Island. Like, I don't know, just bringing one more person to God, that just would be amazing.
My hope is that the students take that experience and come back to Grand Island and say, I want to change our city. Because the reality is we are less than 3 miles away from mission work. Refugees are here, unreached people are here, hurt people are here.
I've helped people, but I never thought about helping people for God. Like I've never, like when I've been helping people, I haven't been thinking I should do this for God. I've just been doing it like for like me or like my outlook.
Our generation can have a big impact if we just start doing instead of waiting for others to lead the way. It doesn't matter where you go, it could be GI or Dallas. What people need to hear is the gospel, and that's what we're called to do.
Simply put, I think the reason we did this was we felt called to do it, and we were just trying to be obedient to God in that calling.
I love our students, like I love our student ministry, I love Element, and God actually commands us to do this. You know, Matthew 28 tells us, go make disciples of every nation, baptizing them in the name of the Holy Spirit. If we're gonna call ourselves Christians and act like believers, we need to be doers of the word.
I just pray that we can kind of create the snowball effect that will keep going and maybe inspire other people to go to Guatemala or do some kind of mission work and get involved somehow. And that we can keep a passion for missions at the forefront of our church.
There's just a lot of need out there. There's a lot of need for people to know who Jesus is right here in our town. And if we don't go and take that message to them, there's a good chance no one will.
Wow, that is an uncommon group of people. They took their spring break, they go to Texas, they serve people, and what we see is that God changes them. And that's the story that they will tell you when you talk to them about that. It was an awesome trip for that group of people, and I want to thank the sponsors who took time out of their lives to take that trip too. Now, we're 24 months into our three-year Uncommon Giving Campaign. And our story tells us that we are uncommonly healthy as a church. And it shows that you're generous, that you're good stewards, and that you're faithful with your lives. And that's a little bit of what I want to show you this morning. And so real quick, I know some of you are curious, well, how are we doing? How are we doing with Uncommon? But I want to tell the story in a little broader stroke. You know, every week if you pick up a bulletin, you'll see on that bulletin a few numbers, and they give you some information about our giving and our attendance, stuff like that, very simple stuff. I know many of you are new to our church. I hope that if you already had a great experience with us, if you're new, one of the important things that we like to do as a leadership of our church is to be full disclosure when it comes to the things that matter in the church's business. And you know, Josh Sykes has a great statement that I quote him all the time: everything in the church is spiritual, everything. And so what I'm talking to you about today, please see it spiritually. Now, I was talking to a guy a while back, it's probably 6 months ago. I was trying to get him to come to our church. And he said, well, I'm not a big fan of organized religion. I said, hey, man, you'll fit right in at Third City Christian Church because we're not organized at all, you know. But he'd been here. He said, no, you're organized. I've been at other churches. And he's right. We are organized in some very important ways, ways that I think should give you confidence, whether you're new here or whether you're one of the core people in our church that just, you're like the ones that hold this church on your shoulders with the power of God in your life. And so I hope that what I show you today will really be encouraging to you no matter where you find yourself at in your history at Third City Christian Church. So here's just a quick update. Last year, we projected our need for giving to be $22,588 a week. Hope you can see this. $22,588. So our offerings every week need to average that if we're going to meet budget. Now, I want you to know we're a very conservative group of people. We do not spend money that we don't have, that you don't give. And so this has been the pattern of our church, and we'll continue that. Now, one of the things that we feel very strongly about as a church is keeping things free as possible. So there's two ways that that happens at Third City Christian Church. The most important way in my mind is that people volunteer. We need 600 volunteer slots to be filled every week at our church, 600 slots. There is probably about 400 people in our church who fill those slots. So as you can see, we have a gap in what we need, and we also know that a growing church like us, it's always going to be our need to have more volunteers. Volunteers are the lifeblood of our church. And so if you're a person who's volunteering here in any way, whatever you're doing, I just want to say thank you. We could not do it without you. You're what it's all about. But the second way that we're able to keep things free as possible is when you give, when you're generous, because that allows for our ministry to thrive. Now, I want to show you what happened last year. In 2016, as I said, the giving that we needed to meet budget was $22,000 plus change. You gave $24,420 on average. So, in other words, you're giving. I wrote this wrong. Get rid of this. That's, you know, get rid of all that. Forget all that. Forget that. This is out of my comfort zone. I'm telling you this right now. So I want you to see in a very positive way, you gave that way. Now, that's very important, especially last year because we did what? Built buildings, right? And so we had all kinds of things that came in with that. Now, I think we were pretty good about managing all of that on the front end. But we were able to, for instance, finish out the buildings a little bit better so that when new people came, they'd feel welcomed. And we were able to do something that it seems like we're always trying to do more of around here, which is to add more parking, because that's always an issue at Third City Christian Church. And so thank you for that faithfulness. I hope that you see that. I hope that you see the faithfulness that exists there. Now, that being said, you know, we look at 2016, and when we make our budget for 2017, we wanted to be as close as we could to meet our needs with the number that we see you giving in 2016. So our revenue goal for 2017 is $24,781. Sorry, I'm bending over and you're seeing that. That's our goal, and if you notice, it matches up pretty well with what you gave last year, right? Makes sense, I think, right? And again, the reason that, you know, we've tried to meet that is not only that you gave that much in 2016, so we think you're capable of doing it in 17 or maybe more, but also we are about 3 years behind in staffing needs as a church. And so we would like to fill a couple key staff needs in 2017. We need help in our worship ministries because we provide a wide variety of worship opportunities during the course of the week, and it's very taxing on our staff. And we also are hoping to add an executive pastor or minister who can help us with organization and to do what we do even better. So those are two roles we'd like to fill. Now, I'm glad to be able to tell you that we're like 9 weeks in right now, so this is still incomplete, but you've given, on average, to date, $28,452, right? So congratulations to you, right? Look at that chicken scratch. Yeah, and so I'd say congratulations, keep it up. You know, because that's a beautiful thing for a preacher. I can tell you that. It takes a lot of stress off the preacher when that's going on. I can tell you that right now. So thank you. I'll thank you for that. Now, those of you who were here 2 years ago, should have had Vanna White come up here with me and do all this for me. It would have been easier. But Jackie's gone, so I couldn't do that. All right, so those of you here a couple years ago, you know that we challenged our congregation. We said, would you open your hearts and open your hands and give so that we can reach more people? And we called that Uncommon, and that's what we're calling it. It's a 3-year campaign to build buildings. Now, we've already built the buildings. We're almost finished with that process. We have a few little details to hammer out. But so we challenged the congregation. And we tallied it up, and it came to roughly, and I'm just going to do rough numbers here, 2 million, and let's just say 97,500. Okay, let's just say that for. So you said we'll give $2,097,000 and change to Uncommon over a 3-year period. And that was, in my mind, a great, great number at that time because we knew we were going to need every bit of that. Now, we are 2 years through the process, 24 months in, and so far, it's in your bulletin, you've given $1,564,545. So let's just say, I'm just going to just round change it, $1,564,000, roughly, in, you know, right? That, I don't know how you can make anything out of that. Anyway, you get the point. Here's the most important thing. That represents 75% of the goal with a year to go. So again, very strong, very good. We're very happy about that. It just takes a lot of pressure off a preacher to see that happy. Now, you want to give a preacher a heart attack, though? You do what happened to a friend of mine in Chicago. He's actually the minister of my daughter's church. He's the senior minister of my daughter's church at Willow Creek North, and they just finished a $35 million building. It's their first building they've ever been in. They rented facilities up till that point, and they had a very good campaign like us. Everything was good, but some guy walks up to him after they were in the building a week or so, and he said, hey, Steve, hey, great to see these buildings, wonderful. I guess that means I can stop giving to the building campaign now. And he said, Elizabeth, I'm coming home, you know. I mean, he was like, no, we're not done yet. We're not done yet. Even though our commitment level is about 2.97, the buildings cost us right at $3 million. That's what the project cost us when it was all said and done, which is exactly what we thought it would be. So, you know, we still have some work to do. We have a year to go to finish out our campaign. We want to finish it out strong, and we appreciate your faithful support to do that. You know, when we challenge people about these things, we always say not equal gifts, but equal sacrifice. So whether you're a kid on an allowance, or whether you're a teenager who has a part-time job, or you're a person who's, you know, very wealthy, we just ask people to do what you can do with where God puts you in life. And by the way, we do have kids and teenagers who have made a commitment, who are fulfilling a commitment to the Uncommon campaign, and they're doing it. So one of the big reasons why we're ahead of schedule is that many of you who are new to our church since this happened, you came new since 2016, you've started giving to our building fund, which is a big help, and we thank you. I want to say a special thanks to Brian Mustian, to Brett Mader, to Taylor Jones, Ano Sika. I mean, they carried a lot of the heavy lifting when it came to getting these buildings up. Would you just thank them for me? They just did a great job because it took pressure off of me and off of us to have them with their eyes on that project and helping with it in such a great way. And so thank you. And I want to thank you, those of you who have faithfully given to Uncommon. Now, you're thinking, well, that's all great. Is this preacher, is that what he's about? You know, that's not what we're about. And so maybe you're thinking, well, what good did that do? I mean, that we went to all that effort and we went into a capital campaign to build buildings. We actually built buildings. Well, here's some fun facts, just something for you to think about. So when we moved into the plaza and this expanded seating area, our average attendance at that time was about 1,035. That was our average attendance on a Sunday. That does not include Wednesday night, where there's 300 students who come here and worship every Wednesday night. Many of them, that's their worship service. Most of them, by the way. But that's our average attendance before we moved into the new facilities in October. As of our moving in, that has gone to 1,154. So that represents about 11.5% increase in attendance on Sundays, which is tremendous. That's just wonderful. That's what we hoped, right? We hoped that people would come, that people, we'd build this and there'd be places for people to come, that we'd add more seats than needed so that you could be here. And some of you, you're in this, you know, this number. You're the 115 or so people that started coming here since October. And I want you to know that the people who built these buildings, they did so with you in mind. They wanted you to be here. And maybe you come in and say, man, it's like everybody here knows everybody. It's like this is junior high and everybody knows everybody and I just moved into the district, right? So I want you to think about this. If you count down the row, every 9 person here this morning, they're new just like you are. So get to know them, you know? You have a lot in common, right? Now, those of you who have been coming for, maybe you're one of those people that have been here for all the time the church has been here. Let's just go back to the year 2000 when we moved over to 13th Street from Old Flanagan. We relocated in the year 2000. 2001 is when we inhabited our facility. And so when we moved here, our average attendance was 250. And I will tell you that I knew almost everybody. Almost everybody. Now, it took us about 3 or 4 or 5 years to double in attendance to around 450. That's when we built Kids City, our kids' facilities. And by then, I didn't know everybody. So, a pastor wants to know everybody, but I don't. And you probably don't either, because if you've been around all this time, you're going, man, I don't know anybody around here. Well, you do know somebody, you just have to go find them. So here we are now, and during the course of a week, we have 1,500 people worshiping God in this building, 1,500 people who go to a worship service in this building on average. And so there's no way you know everybody, right? So I'm going to tell you to do the same thing with me that we did when we had 250 people. I give you permission to make a complete fool of yourself. I do it every week. And what you do is you just go up to that person you don't know and say, hi, I'm Scott Jones, nice to meet you. And they go, hey, Scott, we were in a small group together 5 months ago. Anybody can relate to that? I mean, that's where I am, right? But you know what? It's important for us to be that person. Like how many of you, just by a raise of hands, how many of you like to sit kind of in the same place every week? You're what we call rudders around here. You're a rudder, right? Okay, so let's use that to a good advantage. So when you come in and you sit in your plop spot, the one that has your name on it, you say, this is my peeps right here. This is my zone right here. I'm gonna look around. I'm gonna see if the other regulars are here. I'm gonna greet them and try to remember their name. And then if I see someone sit in my zone, no, you're not gonna chase them out and say, this is our place, man. Get out of here. You're gonna say, hey, I'm Scott Jones, nice to meet you. And they'll say, thanks, you introduced yourself to me 3 months ago, but it's nice to see you again, you know. But just be the friendliest people you can be. That's what makes this an uncommon church. Now, if you're new here, the people who gave to build these facilities, they did that for you. And we're hoping you'll embrace that same mindset, that uncommon attitude, you know, that says, this is my church, I'm going to be that kind of person for the next person that needs to be here. Because the fact is, we don't want a crowd. That's not what we're looking for. We're looking for a community. We're looking for people who will commune with others, and that's what we're about. And so we want you to be a part of that. Now, with that being said, we have some pretty significant needs right now. And the first great need we have is in our kids' ministries on Sunday morning over in Kid City. We have, you know, 250 kids over there on Sundays. And quite frankly, we have a lot of building space, but we don't have enough volunteers. So if you're a person who could give an hour a week over in Kid City, you're like gold. You're the gold standard of volunteers right now for us. And if that sounds like you, yeah, I can give an hour. I can endure any number of kids for 1 hour a week. I can do that. And I love kids. That's really what we're looking for. Then we would ask you to volunteer there. Now, maybe you have a middle school child or a high school young person in your life. How about the two of you volunteer? What a great way to serve with your teen. Do so in Kid City. It will definitely help us. Another great need that we have is for small group hosts in the homes. We don't do many Bible studies here on site. You say it's a big building, why not? Well, we don't have that many spaces for that. And our buildings are used all week long for other things. But we like to have small groups in homes. And so if you're a person who has a home that has enough seats for maybe 10, 12 people in your living area and you have a television, that's really all it takes, a heart to host people. It's a video curriculum source that you're going to plug in, and then you guys are going to watch the video as a group. You're going to get to know those people because you'll be together for 8 to 10 weeks. And it's a great way to build fellowship and community. And we just need people like that. We're always looking for those kinds of people. And so we would ask you to help with that. Now, we also need servers on Sunday mornings. We need people who greet people. We're going to start a parking lot team this spring, and we need men and women who want to be outdoors and help with the parking lot. It'll be great this spring. It'll be challenging in the winter, but we're going to keep doing it. So we if you can help us with that, we just want to welcome as well as we can. That's what we're about. Now, if you can help us with any of that and you have a smartphone, how many of you have a smartphone? How many of you are smart with your phone? I should ask that for none of you. How many of you have a smartphone? Well, if you have a smartphone and you're interested in giving, if you're interested in helping serve, if you're interested in serving at Kid City, if you're interested in hosting a small group, just text that number on the screen and somebody will contact you. That's all it takes. Or if you don't like that method, you say, I'm not smart enough to do that, go to the hub. It's over in the plaza. Just go there after we're done today and say, hey, I'm here to help. And so I'm going to do that. Now, let me just say this. You've done a great job inviting people to Third City Christian Church. And I'll ask somebody, well, how'd you get here? And they almost always say, well, I have a friend who invited me. I was talking to a lady a while back, several months ago, last fall. And I said, why are you here? How'd you get here? And she said, well, I have a friend who invited me to a Bible study. I said, really? What are you guys studying? And she said, Genesis. And I said, well, good luck with that. That's a hard book, man. Ma'am. But anyway, I asked her, why are you here? She said, I just have this friend. I said, you know, make sure you thank your friend. You know, because she was just raving about our church. I said, you know, the reason you're here is because of your friend. That's why you're here. And that's what we're about. You know, there's a family that comes here every week. I seriously don't think they've ever missed a Sunday. If they have, I can't remember it because I see them all the time. They come on Wednesday nights too. The first time they stepped into this building was when Nick Galvin passed away. And they came for visitation. That was the first time they'd ever stepped foot in this building. And so later on, as they're attending and coming, I'm saying, why are you here? They said, this place is different. We knew it the moment we walked in. That's because of you. You make that possible. That's because of your heart and your gift of being loving to people in the worst possible circumstances. And I want to thank you. You know, I just think that that's the kind of stuff that you need to know, that that's really where it comes down to. Now, if you're newer to our church, we have an event that's called Third City in You. We hold it every 6 or 8 weeks or so. The next one's scheduled for April 19th, 6:30. It's held in the Next Steps room, which is just right across the hallway here. And so come on Wednesday night. If you have kids, bring them to Shine, or if you have students, bring them to Element or both, and then just join us for that. And we'll help you to take the next step. That's what that's all about. Next weekend is one of the great weekends of our church year. We call it Morning of Baptisms. And it's just so exciting because there's going to be numbers of people who are going to respond to Christ and be baptized next Sunday. Now, if you're curious about baptism, you know, maybe you're a person who has never been baptized by immersion and you know that our church teaches that and you want to know more about it, I'll be across the hallway after the service. I'd love to visit with you about it. If you're ready to take that step and be baptized, you can do us a favor by stopping out at the plaza and letting them know that you're going to be baptized next week. But even if you don't do that and you come next week and want to be baptized, we won't turn you away. Now, you're going to get wet in the clothes you wear, so you might want to throw in a spare set of clothes for afterwards. But it's a great day, and we hope that you'll take advantage of that because it's a beautiful thing. Well, you know, that's just a little update. I hope it helps you. If you have any questions about that, I'm sure that Parker Lowry can answer any question you have. Other than that, that's me. I shot all the bullets. That's what I got. So let's pray together. God, we're going to go to you in communion now because we're not a crowd. We're a community. And in community, we come to this table of unity. Community and unity, where an uncommon group of people gather under your name, made uncommon by Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, our God and our Lord. And so we remember your great sacrifice. We commune remembering the price you paid so we could gather here and love you and be loved by you. Amen.